गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, आई एम आनंद भतंगे, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर फ्रॉम मैकेनिकल डिपार्टमेंट एंड माय टुडेज प्रेजेंटेशन टॉपिक इज डिजाइन ऑफ गियर. डिजाइन ऑफ गियर शुड, बिफोर स्टार्टिंग डिजाइन ऑफ गियर वन शुड नो अबाउट स्ट्रेंथ ऑफ मटेरियल, थियरी ऑफ मशीन एंड ऑल्सो मशीन डिजाइन वन. ओके, देन ऑल्सो वन कैन गेट डिजाइन ऑफ गियर्स. ओके, so first of all, introduction of gears. Introduction of gears, we are going to what gears because of slipping of belts and rope causes reduction in velocity ratio. Okay, let us consider we are moving on hilly area and after acceleration our automobile will start slipping. Okay, so that will cause loss in human life or loss in properties. Okay, and in another case, if you consider in precision machine like watches, that slipping is causes too much loss. That is that we have to avoid. Okay, so that to recover that process, we are moving towards frictional wheel. Frictional wheel, what is meant by frictional wheel? We know that in clutch state we are using friction wheel. Let us suppose that it is friction wheel and it is our transmission wheel. When we have transmission power, at that time both friction wheel and transmission power wheel will engage to each other. Okay, so same phenomenon here we are applying on that frictional wheel. So this is a frictional wheel and here one wheel is attached to second wheel with the help of friction only. Okay, one wheel is attached to second wheel with the help of friction. Okay, so as we can see here that power transmission of gear equivalent to friction wheel means we can transmit same power with the help of friction wheels, but the condition is tangential force does not exist that frictional force means, as you can see, that tangential force, that area, that should not in that should not exist than frictional force F is equal to mu upon Rn. Okay, if that exists, if that exists means what will happen, that wheel will slip each other. Okay, and if that wheel slip again means again loss in human life or loss in properties or loss in precision watches. Okay, so to avoid that slipping in rope belts or to avoid slipping in frictional wheels, we are moving towards gears. Okay, what we are doing in the case of gears, we are providing number of teeth on peripheral. Okay, what we are doing, we are providing number of teeth on peripheral. As you can see in this figure, this is a figure of gears. This is the first, this is a big gear known as the driver gear, and this is the follower, we can also known as the pinion. Okay, and this is the one wheel, this is the second wheel. As you can see, these two shafts are coplanar and parallel to each other, that can be connected with the help of gears teeth. Okay, and there is no chances of slipping. All gears are engaged each other and will transmit same power as it require. Okay, so with the help of this gear we can increase torque or we can increase speed. Okay, by varying its size. Okay, understand? Then also it requires small distance from driver to follower. In the case of rope belt, we have to maintain some distance for maintaining tension in the rope or belt. But in the case of gear, we no need to maintain distance. Here we are required small distance in between two shafts. Okay, next slide. Now we are moving towards classification of gears. First one is according to position of axis of shaft. As we know, these two shafts are coplanar and parallel to each other. As we can see in this figure, these two shafts are parallel to each other. So according to position of axis of shaft, first classification is the parallel axis of shaft. First classification is the parallel axis of shaft. In that case, parallel and coping and shaft connected each other. Okay, so this is the parallel shaft and this is in a plane. This is, if you consider this is a front view, if you consider this is a vertical plane and these two gears are in same plane. Okay, so here we are considering coplanar and parallel shaft. Okay, so here two gears are parallel and coplanar, that is connected with the help of gear. That assembly is known as a spur gear. Okay, that assembly is known as a spur gear because that gear is parallel to axis, because that gear is parallel to axis. Okay, but in this case also there are chances of noise. Okay, so our aim is to again reduce noise, so we are moving towards helical gear. Okay, to reduce noise we are moving towards helical gear. And what is meant by helical gear? We are increasing line of contact, that is mean by we are inclining our gears by axis. As you can see in this figure, this is axis and this is gear. So we are inclining this gear and we are reducing noise as well as we are increasing power efficiency. Okay, so what are the uses of helical gear? We are increasing power, we are increasing line of contact, and we are reducing noise. At that time we are increasing efficiency. Okay, so we are moving towards helical gear. But also in helical gear again there are thrust, there are external thrust. If we are inclining this gear towards external peripheral, then that thrust will develop on external peripheral. As you can see in automobiles tires, if you are giving design like this on tires, that we cannot drive on a straight line. Okay, always there will be one thrust. That thrust will automatically pull to driver. Okay, so avoid this condition in the gear. We are inclining on both sides. Okay, so this condition you may be familiar on automobiles. Okay, so this type of design we are using automobile tire as well as gear transmission system. Okay, so to reduce thrust on external peripheral. Okay, so next slide. Next is according to intersection of axis shaft. Second is a coplanar and non-parallel, or you can see the intersecting axis. Okay, as you know that parallel axis never intersect with each other. Okay, means here second case is a intersecting axis, but in same plane. Okay, as you can see here, two gears are in same plane but intersecting to each other. Okay, this is a vertical plane. Both gears are in same plane but intersecting to each other. Okay, so that power transmission can be done with the help of bevel gear. Okay, so that assembly is known as a bevel gear. As you can say, in this case also there is an inclination of teeth with the axis. There is a small inclination of teeth with the axis. Okay, so with the help of this inclination we can set both axis and we can transmit same power as required. Okay, so the two non-parallel and coplanar shaft connected by gear, that assembly known as a bevel gear. It also have their teeth inclined to axis. Okay, and third one is a non-intersecting and non-coplanar. As we can see, both types there is a common phenomenon, that is a two gears should be in a plane. Okay, two gears should be in one plane. But this third classification consists of non-intersecting and non-coplanar. Means this one is a first gear and this one is a second gear. Okay, so as you can see, these two axes are non-parallel to each other and they are intersecting to each other. Also, that both gears are not in a single plane. First one is a this one, second one is a inclined plane. Okay, so that can be transmitted with the help of a spiral gear. Okay, so that can be power can be transmitted with the help of spiral gear. Okay? And that spiral gear will maintain a line contact. Okay? Next line. Then according to type of gearing. Okay? According to type of gearing, first one is an external gear. As you can say, external gear means square gear, spiral gear. That are the external gear. Teeth are on the external periphery of the gear. Okay? Motion of two wheels is always unlike, means the first one is a moving clockwise and second one should rotate in an anti-clockwise direction. Okay? Then larger of two wheels is called as a gear and second smaller is called as a pinion. Then the gear of shaft meshes externally, second type is a rack and pinion. Okay? Second type of gear according to type of gearing is a rack and pinion. In this type what we are doing? We are converting rotational motion into transition motion or transition motion into rotational motion. That assembly is known as a rack and pinion assembly. Okay? In that case, the gear or shaft meshes externally or internally with the gears in a straight line. Okay? That straight line is called as a rack and that gear is called as a pinion. As you can say in a previous case, pinion is a small gear. So in that case, what will be the gear is known as a pinion and what will be the line is called as a rack. Okay? The straight line gear is also called as rack and circular gear is known as a pinion. Okay? Next slide. Then internal gearing. Internal gearing means gear having teeth on internal periphery. Okay? Which will the bigger one is having internal peripheral internal teeth and smaller one is having on external teeth. Okay? So two shaft mesh internally with each other, larger of those two wheels called as a another wheel and smaller is called as a pinion. As you can see that smaller is called as a pinion as per previous and that larger is called as a annular wheel. Okay? Then according to peripheral velocity of gear. Okay? Gear are classified on velocity. Then first one is a low velocity, that is less than 3 meter per second. That is our precision washer and small machines. Then medium velocity in between 3 to 15 meter per second. Then high velocity, that is more than 15 meter per second. Okay? Next. Now terms used in gear. Okay? Before designing gear, you should know all the terms that include on gear. Okay? You might be familiar with these terms, but again I am repeating. First one is a pitch circle. Okay? Pitch circle, that is an imaginary circle that will give you same power output as a gear. In that case, this one is a pitch circle. So, and second is a pitch surface element. So, on the pitch circle, we can see this is a pitch circle element. This one is a pitch circle element. Okay, that element which having on pitch circle. Okay, second one is an addendum. Addendum, it is a distance between pitch and top surface of the gear. Then redundum, it is a radial distance between pitch and bottom surface of the gear. Then third one is addendum circle. If you draw a circle on top of the gear, that will give you addendum circle. If you draw a circle on bottom of the gear, that will give you redundum circle. Then circular pitch is a distance between two corresponding points on the gear. Distance between two correspond points on the different tooth. Okay? I am making correction. It is the distance between two corresponding points on two teeth. Okay? That distance is known as a circular pitch. Then clearance, it is the distance between meshing, top of the meshing gear to the bottom of the gear. This is a, if you are considering another gear that meshing in this place, then distance between top of the meshing gear to the bottom of the gear. Then total depth, total depth, it is again addition of radial distance of addendum and dedendum. Then working depth, that working depth means it is a distance that will cover by meshing of the gears. In that case, working depth is this is a working depth, addendum plus dedendum. Okay, in that clearance will also improve. Next. Okay, next one is a long gearing. It is a very important law, that condition for constant velocity ratio. Okay, as we know that in automobile we are required constant velocity, okay, for stability of automobile, or many cases like watch we are required constant velocity, okay, precision. So as we can say, here we are considering two teeth of different gears. First gear is a, let us consider one, that is pinion. Second is a two, that is gear. Okay, so in that case, here the portion showing by darker line that are contact to each other. Okay, so T will be tangent to the point of contact. N will be normal to the point of contact. This figure is very complicated. I will draw separately here. Point of contact is Q. Point of contact is Q. This is a tangent TT. A tangent TT. Then M. That will be normal. This is tangent TT, this is normal N, okay. This is our point Q, okay. So let us consider that this is point O2, this is point O1, okay. This is point O1. Center of pinion. This is point O2, center of gear. Okay. Then let us first of all draw perpendicular to the normal from center of pinion. Okay. Then draw perpendicular to the normal from center of gear. Okay. So here, if you are considering this first gear, this is second gear. So our velocity V1 will be for first gear is V1, okay, that is denoted by vector QC for this is V1. Second one is a for pinion, this is V2, okay, this is V2, it is QD, okay, it is making angle with the normal alpha and beta, okay, it is making angle with the normal alpha and beta, and here we are considering this triangle. Here we are considering this triangle equal to here one simple consideration is the triangle MQO1 is equal to triangle NQC. Here we are considering this condition, and triangle NO2 cube equal to triangle DQN. Okay, so then also we can prove this law of gearing. Then the angle cos alpha equal to, so in that case portion TT be the common tangent and MN be the common normal to the curves at a point Q. Okay, so for constant velocity we should consider V1 cos alpha is equal to V2 cos alpha, as we are considering this triangle equal to this triangle and this triangle equal to this triangle. So for constant we are considering V1 cos alpha is equal to V2 cos alpha. So we know that V is equal to R omega. So R omega 1 into R, what is in the R? R is radius, that is O1 cube. O1 cube is radius. Then V2 is equal to omega O2 cube is equal to then cos alpha. As you know that triangle cos alpha is equal to O1M divided by O1 cube. This is the cos alpha. This is a right angle triangle. This is O1M divided by O1 cube. O1M divided by O1 cube. Then this is also right angle triangle. This is a cos alpha, sorry, cos beta. Then O2N divided by O2 cube. O2N divided by O2 cube. Okay. Then that O1 cube and O1 cube will cancel each other. In this case, O2 cube and O2 cube will cancel each other. What will remain? O1 into O1M is equal to W2, sorry, omega 2 into O2 into N, O2N. Then if you simplify this, we can write omega 1 divided by omega 2 is equal to O2N divided by O1M. Okay? So if you are considering this triangle, if you are considering this triangle, it will give you omega 1 divided by omega 2 is equal to O2N divided by O1M. Okay? But if you are considering, if you are extending this point line of contact, that point Q towards point P, means that point of contact to the pitch circle. We are extending point of contact to the pitch circle, okay? That will give you O2N omega 1 divided by omega 2 is equal to O2P divided by O1P, okay? If you are equating these two equations to each other, will give you omega 1 divided by omega 2 equal to O2N divided by O1M equal to O2P divided by O1P, okay? And that is a condition for constant velocity, that is angular velocity ratio is inversely proportional to the ratio of distance of P from center, okay? But it is saying angular velocity ratio is inversely proportional to ratio of distance, angular velocity is inversely proportional to ratio of distance from P to next gear. Okay, so that is law of gearing or condition of constant velocity. That is okay. Thank you.